The Zhiyun company has released a new gimbal, which is the Weebill 2. Let's find out, is it any good? What's good, guys? My name is Oleg Nikitin. You're watching No Limits on channel from Russia with love. And today we're playing with the Weebill 2 gimbal from Zhiyun company. I've already made two big reviews for the RSC2 from DJI and RS2 from DJI as well. There is the link in the YouTube card and in the description below. I forgot the name of it for a second. And of course, I'll be comparing this gimbal to those two, but I don't have them in hand because I used the Ronin S original, but will be compared with the newer generation of gimbals with DJI gimbals. So the size and weight. In terms of the size, this is a pretty bulky gimbal, I'd say, but it can be kind of stripped down to kind of portable size. But the RSC2 is better because of the foldability, and the RS2 is better because it has detachable handle, so it gives it the third place in terms of compactness. And in terms of the weight, here where the things get more interesting, because this gimbal, the Weebill 2, weighs 1.5 kilograms, the RSC2 weighs 1.3 kilograms, and the RS2, the biggest kind of gimbal, weighs only 1.1 kilogram, which is great, and it has kind of carbon fiber in it, some, you know, sorcery. And yeah, this is the heaviest one among all three and kind of the bulkiest one. But Weebill, the S model, or the first Weebill generation, was super lightweight gimbals from Zhiyun company, but now it's getting towards the heavy side. The payload of those gimbals. The Weebill 2 has 3.5 kilograms of payload, the RSC2 has 3 kilograms of payload, and the RS2 is just incredibly huge, 4.5 kilograms of payload, which is nuts. Let's talk the quality of stabilization. I took this gimbal together with me to shoot in the Moscow city center with a Suray 75mm f1.8 anamorphic lens, a pretty bulky lens and a really telephoto lens, considering that it's a crop lens, so it was kind of 105mm, and I wasn't really surprised with the stabilization quality. As you can see in those shots, they all need to have extra stabilization. And of course, I have stabilized everything correctly in terms of the camera. I have calibrated the gimbal, but out of the box it wasn't giving me the good result. Even when I used my 17-28 2.8 Tamron lens with a very wide angle view, you know, 17mm, it was giving me the shakiness a little bit and the little wobbliness in the shots. And later on, I've tried it in my backyard together with 24-70 f4 stabilized lens, and I was trying it without image stabilization, with standard steady shot, and with active steady shot. And as you can see, with the steady shot on, it's much, much better. And the camera IBIS system is reducing this micro jitters from the gimbal itself. Maybe I have to tweak it a little more, but I was setting the motor settings correctly, everything was balanced correctly, stabilized and all that, but for some reason it's not providing me with the best stabilization. Comparing to the Ronin RSC, I mean the DJI RSC2, it's worse, and the RS2 is the total winner, is just as stable as the rock. So kind of so-so in terms of stability. Let's move on. By the way, we have two different kits, the basic kit, which is right here, and the pro kit, which includes, you know, the video wireless transmission system, the follow focus, and all the goodies from this. But I don't really use this combos. I used it with the Ronin RSC2, DJI, I mean, and I kind of find it so-so. So in this box, we do have the box itself made out of foam. It's kind of only the top. And here we have the gimbal itself, the plate. It's a Manfrotto plate, but we'll talk about it in a second. It has some quirks. The riser plate, the kind of helping and supporting arm for your heavy lenses, a little bolt to mount this supporting arm to your plate, and also a lot of cables, the charging cable and the control cables for all of the cameras existing, I guess. And yeah, I don't really use those cables, and I prefer not to use all of the features, some of like recording, start, stop and all that. It's just too many cables to me to use. So you can check which cameras are supported and which functions are supported on the website of the Zhiyun. Thank you. Goodbye. Nah, let's move on. Build quality. I was really astonished by the build quality, and of course Zhiyun company has reached DJI's level of quality of the RSC2 and RS2 gimbals, because they have kind of the same locking mechanisms for the all three axes. Pretty nice tilty flippy screen, which is really well made, and everything is solid. We have here a little flip for pan follow mode, lock mode and follow mode, which is great, but it kind of switches back to pan follow, if I'm not mistaken, or to follow mode when you turn the gimbal off, and when you turn it back on, you need to kind of reflip this switch, which is not really good. Also here we have a little screw mount, your quarter inch mount, your Rosetta mount, or how do you call it, I guess it's a Rosetta mount, also with a quarter inch thread, and overall build quality, the trigger, the fit, the tripod fit are really sturdy, and ergonomically it's a really well made product. Thumbs up for the Zhiyun company for the build quality. And now about the issue with the plate. It's a Manfrotto plate, as they say, but this plate doesn't fit to my eImage GH06, doesn't fit to my monopod from Manfrotto. Almost everybody, every videographer has this monopod, I guess, or had this monopod. And basically, it's the only thing where this plate fits, right here. You can use the Manfrotto plate, the original Manfrotto plates from the monopod, for instance, and it will fit right here, and it's working perfectly, but it has the little unlock mechanism, kind of a safety feature, and it doesn't work with the original Manfrotto plate. You'll have to be very careful when you put the camera from the gimbal, out of the gimbal, away from the gimbal, how do you say it? So yeah, why do you make it like so? I cannot use this plate with any of my extra tools like monopods or tripods. Just make it the same. I don't understand it. In terms of ergonomics, it's okay, it's a very nice gimbal to hold, and if you are right-handed, you are really easily reaching the thumbstick, I mean the joystick. But if you're left-handed, you don't have this ability. Matt Johnson was talking about it in his review, and I really agree with you, Matt. I'm a right-handed person, but from time to time I use my left hand when my right one is tired, for instance. And yeah, you also have this record button right here. You can reach it with your thumb. The switch, I've talked about it before, and the little wheel for your ISO changes, for your shutter changes, or for your roll axis. You can customize it right here on the monitor itself. So let's talk about the monitor. The screen. This is the first gimbal to implement the screen inside of the gimbal, and it's a really nice feature. I didn't see it anywhere before, and it's really working nicely. So here we have all of the settings. Also here we have the battery life. We have the mode dials, we have the balance check, advanced features like time-lapse and motion-lapse, I'll show it to you in a minute. Also here we have the parameter settings, the motor strength, the smoothness, the follow speed, the joystick responsiveness and the dead band, which is also great, the auto calibration function, reset parameters, the control wheel functions like aperture, ISO, shutter or roll. As you can see here, it's rolling, let's roll. Fine-tuning if you need to adjust your tilt or roll axis just a little bit, the focus motor control, the language control. It was in Chinese when I first got it and I was kind of frustrated, but I found the solution. And also we have the video transmission charging feature, but we need a pro combo for this. Overall, you don't need the app. It does have an app, but it's kind of a basic app and I don't really love to use it, and it's more of towards the mobile videography. So this gimbal is kind of the thing in itself, and it's 100% okay without the app. You can tweak all of the features, all of the things right here, and it's a great addition, I guess. The modes. We have the pan follow mode, the lock mode where it's locked, of course, the follow mode when it follows the pan and tilt axis, also the POV mode when you fly like a small POV drone in your hands. The go mode is very fast and kind of woof woof. I'm showing the modes to you right here, right now. And the vortex mode, kind of, you know, a regular mode when it's 360 rotating. And also the portrait mode, if you like the Insta stories a lot. It's also built in right here, and it's a good thing to have. All in all, it's a good number of modes, and you can definitely go into the mode section on the screen and choose the good one. No need for an app. And it's also said that it has the dolly zoom mode, I don't really use it, and the hyperlapse and time-lapse mode for your stills photos and for your video mode. You simply set the A point, and the B point, and it goes from one point to another. Here is the hyperlapse I was able to shoot with this little gimbal. What's the accent? And since we're talking about the Pro Combo, it costs $900, it has the video wireless transmission system, the follow focus and kind of some other things, like a bag, a proper bag, but I don't really see a reason to buy it, and I'll talk about it in a second. And now, the pittiest and the saddest part about this gimbal, and it's a battery life. Unfortunately, the battery life is said to be 9 hours, but in my testing it was more of a 5 to 6 hours. And Matt Johnson was really complaining about the battery life, and I do agree with him. Because my RSC2 was able to get around 10 hours, RS2 about 12 hours, and has detachable handle, you can have a separate handle charged and use it for 24 hours. My original Ronin S is around 12 hours of battery life. 6 hours is not enough. If you shoot dancing, or in a real estate, it's okay. But if you're shooting a wedding reception with it or something longer, like a big movie, who would shoot a big movie with this gimbal? I don't know. But if you do need more than 5 hours of battery life, probably this gimbal is not for you, unfortunately, because I do love the ergonomics and overall features of this gimbal. And if it becomes more stable, it would be a great, great choice, but this issue is an issue. It does have power delivery and it charges from 0 to 100 in 1.5 hours, which is nice, but I don't see a reason to carry around a power bank to charge it throughout the shoot or to find a wall outlet to charge it while shooting. Probably in some cases you won't have this opportunity. So it is what it is, guys. It's up to you to choose if it's okay for you. And finally, let's talk pricing. This costs $550, whereas the RSC2 costs $500. And I'd prefer RSC2 for stability, foldability, and overall feelings about the gimbal. And also we have the RS2, the bigger brother, and it's $850, which is kind of on the pricier side. So if we're choosing between the RSC2 and the Weebill 2, I'd say it's a tough choice, but to me the RSC2 is a little better choice. And by the way, I was trying to use this gimbal and the RSC2 together with my Sony a7S III, a heavy lens, and on top with the monitor, the Ninja 5, and the gimbals cannot handle this capacity. Whereas my Ronin S, the original one, do handle this weight flawlessly. And to me, it's an important thing because I shoot like so, and I want to be really mobile and just to throw it on a gimbal, take a couple of shots, put it on the monopod, or just take it handheld and use it like so. So all of those gimbals like the RSC2 and the Weebill 2 are not for me. That is why I'm still sticking to my original Ronin S, which is pretty old right now. So guys, overall, the conclusion, this gimbal is nice and it's a real step up from the Weebill, the first model. And it's a step up from the Zhiyun Crane Mark II, for instance, and the first generation, of course, but it has some quirks in it. The quality of stabilization is not on par, in my opinion, and the monitor is kind of, you know, it is what it is. It's working, but it's not the best feature of the gimbal. The battery life is just, it's poor, guys. It's not to me. I don't want to charge my gimbal every time I use it. And yeah. Share your thoughts in the comment section below, guys, and smash the like and subscribe buttons if you use your Ronin S, for instance, for like 3 or 4 days straight and it still has some juice in it, or just if you liked this video. Also, guys, here is my Instagram and a couple of videos for you to watch next. Thank you very much for watching. My name is Oleg Nikitin, and you've been watching No Limits on channel from Russia with love.